Hello. You are about to watch a video produced by the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration. The third phase of addiction is disenchantment. The person uses more and more often and uses larger amounts.
I never really even thought of myself as using. I was having fun. And I never thought of myself as dependent until later when I looked back and realized there were long periods of time when that's all I did was use. Every day. Couldn't get through a day without using something.
During disenchantment, the negative effects outweigh the positive ones. Yet use continues. This is the classic definition of addiction. Continuing use despite negative consequences. We still do not fully understand why some people can stop at this point and others cannot.
A guy handed me that pill and it was called on the street, the terms were doogee, buck action, horse, etc. And I remember snorting that substance and getting real nauseous and sick, and sitting on the toilet stool, not to defecate, but to try to sweat my way through those feelings of what's happening to my body, and praying to the God that whatever God I understood at that time to help me get through that. And of course, I got through that. And I remember seeing that guy the next day, and I was like, "Damn, what was that? Do you have another one?"
At this point, triggers are many, frequent, and very strong. These triggers result in constant thoughts of getting and using the drug or alcohol, and in avoiding the negative consequences. The person's normal life disappears. Now the craving response starts working overtime. The person just thinks about the drug and then has a full-blown physiological response, as if he or she had already used. That craving drives the person to obtain the substance and then to use it. Very little of this process occurs in the rational brain. It happens in the addicted brain. In the disenchantment phase, rational thought is gone and cravings become very powerful. Even situations only slightly related to drug or alcohol use may trigger strong cravings.
And along the way, I found myself continually getting arrested for drunken publics, continually getting arrested for assaults and possession of marijuana and certain drugs.
I was a high school dropout. I had had several interactions with the police. I had caught a couple cases. And by this time, I went from smoking marijuana to smoking crack cocaine. So I was a full-blown crack addict. And I really didn't realize it at the time. I didn't realize I had an addiction. I just thought that I was just having some trying times. But those trying times just spiraled out of control. 4 years, I had lost a lot of respect, or people had lost respect for myself. And it just got out of control to the point where I was panhandling on the corners, selling shoes off my feet, I would sell shoes off your feet. If you allow me to, I would steal, I would rob, I would break in people's homes. And when I was doing these things, I was never proud doing them.
But I just kept going. When I was 16, my mother became ill and was in a lot of medical treatment. She had cancer. And when I was 17, she died. So when I was 16, I started drinking alone. I would take it from... My father had a large stock of alcohol in the basement, and I would just steal it. Or if I went to your house, I would take your alcohol. I would wait till you were somewhere else, and I would find it and drink it. And I just found alcohol wherever I could go.
As my disease progressed and as I got older, it was the same way. I would, you know, hang out with all the people that were drinking and drugging in high school and middle school. And when they were done, I would go use on my own. You know, and my using progressed pretty heavily. I mean, my last few years of high school, I could safely say I was using 5 or 6 days a week.